On the stick. I like your stick. What is this? It's a guard? That's pretty cool.
It's a person that guards stuff.
It's a person that guards stuff. Excellent. I thought it was a Roman, so cool.
What's up? Gates.
They guard gates.
And kings.
And kings. Got it. Do they guard crosses? So if you've ever read through the Gospel of Mark, you're going to notice something. Christ comes, preaches, teaches, and does all these things, and there's one man. Oddly enough, it's a Roman guard, which is especially weird since Jesus is the Jewish Messiah, and he comes, and most of the time he's spent with the Jews and everything like that. And there's this Roman guard at the cross who is the only one recorded of doing something. The only one to confess Christ for who he is. None of his disciples do. Peter says it, but only in private. And then at his death, there's a Roman guard who says truly he is the Son of God. The first time he's proclaimed publicly by anyone, it just happened to be some guy who was also in the part of killing him. And yet, tonight we're going to talk about the temple. And I want you to see how many people it takes. There are 70 verses in here, and most of them are names that neither I nor most of you can pronounce. Therefore, we're going to, it's slightly edited because it's 70 verses, let's be fair. And I don't really want to go through Chronicles every week. So we are in Ezra chapter 2. Please go to Ezra chapter 2. I will not be reading 70 verses, and I don't want you to think I'm making it up. You know what I'm going to read from, like, 2nd Habakkuk or something. See if y'all notice. How many of y'all like 2nd Habakkuk? No? Okay, that's good. My favorite book. There's a lot of sermons out of 2nd Habakkuk.
2nd
Jude's
also good.
Yeah. That's interesting. Ezra 2. Verse 1. Now these were the people of the province who came up out of the captivity, those exiles, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried captive to Babylon. They returned to Jerusalem and Judah, each to his own town. And then we start the list of names.32, 372, 777, 28, 112, 1244, 945, 766, 742, 623, 666, 628, 422, 423, 98, 323, 112, 223, 95, 120, 153, 56, 128, 42, 742, 623, 622, 156, 124, 320, 725, 345, 36, 30. These are the men who just went up with him. This doesn't say who they are, it just says they're people. They're just general people. They're not anybody specific. He then goes on to verse 36. The priests. 973, 1052, 1247, 1017. Then he goes on to the Levites. 74, 128, 139. The temple servants, the sons of Solomon's servants, all the temple servants and the sons of Solomon's servants were 392. Verse 64, the whole assembly together, you ready for this? This is where the numbers start to make sense. The whole assembly together was 42,360. Besides their male and female servants, to whom there were 7,337, and they had 200 male and female singers. There were horses, 736. There were mules, 245. There were camels, 435. There were donkeys, 6720. Some of the heads of the families, when they came to the house of the Lord that was in Jerusalem, made freewill offering for the house of God, to erect it on its site, according to the ability they gave to the treasure of work, 61,000 derricks of gold, 5,000 minas of silver, and 1,000 priest garments. Now the priests and Levites, some of the people, the singers, the gatekeepers, and the temple servants lived in their towns, and all the rest of Israel in their towns. Can you imagine? 50,000 people. 50,000 people. They all come together for one purpose. I want you to reflect back on this temple. This temple is very essential. Again, I'm probably going to say that every week you get used to the concept that it's not like today. It's not. Until that veil is torn, until it's separated, until Christ does his work, God is in the temple. If you want to go see God, you better. Anything else is paganism, pure paganism. They call it, and they said, and they worshiped him on every heel. And that was bad. When they speak of worshiping God on every heel, it's bad, not good. And yet today, if we look at it and we say God is worshiped on every heel, that'd be great. But in this, I want to remind you that this is the temple, that without this temple, there is no worship. There is no communion with God. There is nothing. And 50,000 people come together to do this. And if you think about the temple, you have servants, temple servants, men specifically set up who serve the temple. They know the temple inside out. They know it better than the priests do. They know it better than the Levites do. And you think about it, they were sent. And yet that was not enough. You had people in the beginning, that huge list of numbers. And guess what those people were called? Men. That was it, actually. It says, the number of the men of the people. There you go. Right? I told you the priest line, the Levite line, the servants of the temple, and all these, and then these singers. And yet, the very first one starts out with this, just people. And so they said 50,000 people doing this. In all different ways of life. And all doing different things. And all knowing different things. Could you imagine you're one of these servants of the temple. You're one of these Levites. You're the priest. You know what it's like in every area of this. And then you have these people. These odd, strange people. These weird people who don't even know what it looks like. Because guess what? They weren't supposed to go in once it's finished. Once we finish this temple, we'll kick them out. Trust me, it'll be holy again. Because until it is dedicated, it was safe for them to work on. At the point it's dedicated, they're going to get kicked out. That's the way it works. And so you have these strange people coming in, and they're just doing what they can do. And everybody's doing different parts. And they're all working together. Because they had one focus. And I love that you don't, throughout the whole book of Ezra, you're not going to find, oh, they started fighting with each other. Oh, the Levites were upset. These other guys were, in their way. They didn't know what they were doing. They should get out of the way. The priests were getting upset. They were working on their area. Their mortar was better than their mortar. And you don't have that. You have 50,000 people working together, and the reason they could work together is because of what they were doing. They wanted to worship God. And you think about it. These people who had moved to Babylon, they had been spread out. And King Cyrus offers them a chance to come back in. And 50,000 of them decide they're going to come back in, and they're going to rebuild this temple. And men who, not even the most religious of them, they're not even allowed. They're not Levites, they're not Aaronites, they're not Solomon's servants, they're not temple servants, they're just people. They're just everyday people. And these everyday people decide that it is so essential to worship God, and it is so important to them that they leave their homes. They leave what they got used to. They've lived here for 50 years. Wherever they were put by Nebuchadnezzar, they've lived there for 50 years now. They're going to a strange land. 50 years is a long time to pass. They built homes. They have stuff there. And they decide they're going to leave everything because God is that important. It sounds really similar to this other guy who said, leave everything and follow me. And he goes to one guy and he says, you know what? Come and follow me. He says, I'm going to go bury my father. And he goes, let the dead bury the dead. Come and follow me. And he goes to another one. I've just bought oxen and I haven't even broke them in yet. And he says, leave that and follow me. And then you have other men who says, you know, I want to follow you, Jesus. And he says, the foxes have holes, the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. The hardest no he could have probably given by saying, I don't have any place to lay my head. Do you really want to follow me? And then we have the disciples, these 70 men, at least 70, we know there's a few more, but there's at least 70, and they leave their homes. And they go out and they teach, and he sends them out two by two. And the only thing we find out about them is that they leave everything. We read about the calling of the apostles, and, you know, one of them leaves a family business. Zebedee had built a family business. He had ships. He had servants working for him. He had a good family business. And Jesus comes to them and says, come, follow me. They leave everything. Andrew and Peter. We know Peter's married. Come, follow me. They go back by his house. But he gives the same call to all of them. He says, whoever puts their hand to the plow and looks back is not worthy to be my disciple. And those ordinary men are called to something much greater because we understand that the temple was just Israel's place of worship. We understand that the temple is so far surpassed by the temple, which is the church, which is us, which is the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. And there's 50,000 of them ready to do what they can. And I'm just going to tell you, if you just talk to people as though they're just people, I mean, these are the terms they use, people, and you go, oh, I'm just somebody else. Go back to this guy. Okay, so you've got your life, you've got your teaching, you know what you know. And I want to tell you about this guy. This guy is bottom of the barrel, okay? If you have a worse job than executioner, please raise your hand. I will apologize to you right now. Hold up, you got proof though, so be careful. How many of y'all think you have a worse job than executioner? Every Friday night, you go out and nail somebody up and then hang them on a cross. You know, put it out on the city so everybody can see. Come on. How many of you are of a group of people that lives among people that absolutely hate you, and some of them are carrying swords? The zealots are there, and they're waiting for you to turn your back so they can just slip one in your back. This is these guys. These guys do not want to be stationed where they're at. They're stationed in Jerusalem, home of the zealots. The zealots believed that God's kingdom was superior to everything, and these Roman demons, what were they called? I don't remember the name we talked about this morning. What was the Roman demons called? Legions. The Roman word for the Roman army. A legion. And their hatred of Rome. And everything Rome did to them. And this terribly placed man proclaimed Jesus as Lord. Now, you can have your 50,000 people who, you know what, they were dedicated, they left everything. And I'm still excited about this guy. I'm excited about that guy or gal. Guys, not one sex to me, sorry. Apologize. Yankee things. Guy, person. That person who is willing to say, truly he was the Son of God. That person who's willing, that's just a person, they don't, you know, have any specific titles, don't invent specific names, don't invent specific jobs, anything. That person who, no matter how terrible life is willing to proclaim the Son of God. Because all these people right here, that's awesome. It is. 50,000 people working together in the temple is awesome. But I skipped a passage of scripture in this. I told you I'd read a lot. Verses 59 to 63. I'm going to read some names. I'm just making them up, don't I? Verse 59. The following were those who came from Tel Malah, Tel Harshah, Sherub, Adan, and Ur. Though they could not prove their father's houses or their descent, whether they belonged to Israel, the sons of Delah, the sons of Tobiah, the sons of Nekoda, 652. Also the sons of the priests, the sons of Habiah, the sons of Hakos, sons of Barzillai, who had taken a wife from the daughters of Barzillai, the Gileadites, and was called by their name. These sought their registration among the enrolled in the genealogies, but they were not found there. And so they were excluded from the priesthood as unclean. The governor told them that they were not to partake of the most holy food until there should be a priest to consult Urim and Thummim. How many of y'all know that's essential to us today? How many of y'all heard that and you were like, I'm thinking about Jesus right now? Because I've told you before, and this is more of the great Jewish history, but is post-Jesus. They got lost in the genealogies. So what we need to do is remember this is the treatment of those who they can't find it. I'm not asking if they can serve God. I'm not asking if they can serve as priests. I'm not asking if they can offer sacrifices. I'm not asking if they can do the work of the priest. I'm asking if they can eat food. I don't even know if they can enter which part of the temple. I don't even know if they're Israelis. I'm not asking me those questions. I'm saying, can they eat food? And the governor told them, are you ready? They were not to partake of the most holy food. So the food dedicated for the Levites, much less the priests, much less the Aaron, right? The high priest. And they said they can't have food. The reason this is so essential to us right now is because, and with everything lost, somebody should have figured out something. This all ends. This list of people all ends. This list of people, and I want you to see this division, even though it is a very long chapter, I want you to see how they were divided. You had just the people, the priests, the Levites, the temple servants, Solomon's temple servants, they were special. And you have these groups, and they're all divided. And you know what I love about Christianity? There are no more of those lists. I love this side note. Have y'all seen this?
Yeah.
There you go. Somebody read this side note. Good job. Do you notice how many groups we had? How many groups is this? I'm very tall. How many groups is this? How many groups is this? And the great thing is, I want you to get this, and I want you to understand this pretty clearly, that in Christianity, this all goes away. Because who's the high priest in here?
Jesus.
Who else? Who are the priests?
We are the priests.
We! Every single one of us gets to be in the category. And you know what? From the way it's described, we're not just the priests. We're the Aaron priests. We're the ones who get to go before God. And in a strange story, what we need to remember is this whole list only becomes under one. Because if we read this in Christianity, it would read like this, and the priests are 50,000. I could skip all that reading, just said, and the priests are 50,000. And we will let people tell us what we can do. We'll let people tell us where we belong. You think that happened with the priests? Do you think the priest going to the temple and... I'm just a priest. Do you think they go in the temple and go, yeah, I get to serve God? That's not really that big deal. Because if you do, let me tell you, I've got a little passage for you. And the governor told them that they were not allowed to partake of the most holy food. Don't eat the food. Don't eat the food that belongs to them. Yes, there was a difference. And these priests were set apart, and these priests were special in this, and these groups were divided, because that's how it was. You had groups that were different. And today, we have let that come into our faith. We have let those concepts come into us. And one of the things I mock as much as I possibly can, and I'll be honest, I intentionally mock it, is the preacher. Because y'all think he's something. I think he's a priest, but y'all are too. I think he gets up here and preaches to himself a lot of times, which that's your fault. And y'all are convinced that's right. I just want to, I don't know how to convince you. Did you know you got the same Holy Spirit? Did you know that when God led this, he said, I don't have five groups of people. I don't have the people and then those who are important. He said, I got the people. And they're all priests. Now we have people in the church. We have elders. Make decisions. We have deacons who work hard. But yet when it comes to being a priest, being a representative of God, nobody gets that. Nobody gets to say, I'm the representative of God, because it's already taken by all of us. None of us get to say, I should be out there telling people about Jesus, because that's all of us. Because if you're the ambassador for a country and you go there and go, oh, yeah, what was I supposed to tell you about? You're probably getting fired. I mean, you could just imagine the German ambassador coming over here and going, I forgot what I was going to talk about. I know I was supposed to meet with you today. It was on my little memo pad. And so I'm here. But I don't remember what I'm supposed to do. And, they go to their hotel because, it's on their memo pad. And they go to these meetings because it's on their memo pad. And they do these things because it's on their memo pad. And they forget their job. And we do that. We've got these things on our memo pad that we're supposed to do. And anything not on that memo pad, we're not really thinking about. Because I get up Monday morning, right? Let's get up every morning. Go to work. That's on my list. There's an alarm on my phone that specifically says, wake up, wake up. Okay? I got another alarm. It says, pick up your son. It's always bad when I miss that one. So, I go over there and pick up my son. I get another alarm that says, think about going to bed. I mean, it's on my memo pad, don't worry. Very organized, actually, it's really weird. And I've got this memo pad of things to do. And Sunday morning, I've got this, thing, and it says, wake up, Sunday. So I wake up, because it told me to wake up. And then I've got this other one that says, wake up again, it's Sunday. And I've got this memo pad of things to do. And I've got this list of things to do. And in all the middle of it, guess what I forget to do? To realize that memo pad is just things that are on the memo pad. Because the Bible can't tell us and say, you know what you need to do? You need to be my representative. Now at 10:30 Monday morning, you're going to meet somebody next to the copier. Okay? You're going to go to the copier. You're going to meet somebody, that person next to you. You now represent God. They know that. They're not on the list. And that's how bad it would be if the German ambassador forgot he was the ambassador for Germany. And we're the ambassador for the heavenly kingdom. I know some of y'all love flying flags. I haven't seen anybody's pickup trucks, but I think that's a Texas thing, because everybody owns a pickup truck. And you have these huge flags in the back, and you get like 2 miles to the gallon because they're so big it like pulls the car backwards. You stop and it actually goes the direction of the flag. And yet, they'll do that. But when it comes to being an ambassador for a greater country, when it comes to being an ambassador for heaven and the God, remember 50,000 people, one guy. Okay, 50,000 people coming over here, and It was just a temple. And yet today you have this amazing thing, and you know what? And it's not our merit, but God can't tell you this is Christianity. You can't even make it a checklist. Because it would have to be huge, and I would have to look up my name and be like, okay, 10:30, you're going to meet this person. But instead, if you're the priest, you just kind of figure out you're the priest. You don't even walk around and go, I wonder what I am. You're the priest. Every one of you is the priest. And I hate to say it, how many other people were there? At least five. I know the women were there. The women didn't deserve Jesus. I know there's at least five more people who have followed Jesus for most of his ministry because they were supporting it. And they're all there, and this one guy doesn't forget. He's a Roman soldier. He is a nasty Roman soldier. That he's stationed in Jerusalem. His job is executions. Ugh. How's this guy? And he decides to be a better priest than all those other followers. So tonight, it's a strange lesson in that we have to understand that all these people divided in all these groups. And this looking through genealogies and this searching and consulting the Thummim and the Cummim, trying to get the prophecy aligned to figure out, you know, who was supposed to be there. And today, you know what? It's already been rolled. We already know it. They drew straws. The Thummim and Urim have been consulted. You're on the list. God has already consulted the Thummim and the Cummim. I know, it's Urim and Thummim. It's okay. It's already been consulted. Guess what? You were on that list. If you belong to God, and God is your Lord, then you are His priest. You may eat of His holy things. You may serve in His temple. You may be His. You are His representative. Amen? And Ezra should be so encouraging to you because you know what's great? There's a guy like this. That's awesome. A guy like this. A nobody, really. I wouldn't want his job, I'm sorry. I mean, execution is bad enough. Living in Jerusalem with people that want to kill me the whole time. While doing executions of those people. Could see it wouldn't be a great day for you. And he, in the middle of his checklist of things to do, was a representative for heaven. And the Thummim has been consulted. And you are a priest. Tonight we have an invitation. That invitation is to be just that. To be God's representative. To be God's priest. That he paved the way for you. If there's anybody who has not believed Jesus as Lord, repent of your sins, giving them over to God, confess Jesus as Lord, been buried with him in baptism so that he can raise you up something glorious, so that you can walk with him and have a life abundant here and have a life eternal there. If there's anybody tonight who you haven't been his priest, you haven't been his representative, you've been doing life, and God hasn't been the centerpiece, God hasn't been your focus, and you haven't been serving like he needs, because we're his messengers now. Or if you have other sins that are keeping you from being his priest, and you want to get those over, or if there's anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here. We ask you to come now as we sing.